regarded by many as, if not the most authoritative, then certainly a most authoritative textual expert in the area of Islam and forensic investigations and all these things. He is currently at Hartford after many years, I think 20, at Temple and various other universities before that, even a stint in Canada. Phyllis Tribble is likewise well known, but you see, we were showing off. Everybody here is worthy, but we were putting stars on stage.
For the divorce. So two rights that are given to women, not to be harmed when they agree to a divorce, or the husband wants to divorce them, or if a husband accuses the wife of anything, and he is the only witness, then again, the wife is denied a right that is given in the Quran. This is creating a contradiction in the Quran that I believe when you follow the life of the Prophet, you don't go to the Hadith. I don't go to the Hadith. I say the Quran, the life of the Prophet, if I don't find an answer, then the Hadith. But first, the life of the Prophet. The Prophet faced this exact situation, and what did he do? He went away. So that is how I believe that it should be interpreted. And that's why it's a great blessing that the Sublime Quran is the first English translation to use the words go away in chapter 4, verse 34.
Dr. Bakhtiar, I had every confidence that you were going to be able to do that for us, and I put it almost in a provocative manner in the question to be sure that everybody was able to hear you articulate those very things as well as you did, and we're grateful to you for it, because we get so much stuff not only from the media, but from Muslim, we will say, apostate persons in either Holland or Britain or Canada, who tell us the reason they have left Islam is because of the miserable treatment that women get as prescribed by the Quran. And we needed you to help us understand that.
Yes, I should, sorry, just to end it to say that this will not end domestic violence. Unfortunately, domestic violence is prevalent throughout the world. Doesn't matter what someone's religion is, or no, they have no religion. It doesn't make any difference. There's still issues of domestic violence and women being beaten and in the shelters. But the problem with this is that it's done in the name of God. And that's what it has to be.
I have a brief comment and a question to my dear sister. The comment is that Islamic family law is very problematic. It's based on three sources: on the Quran, on the prophetic tradition, Sunnah, and on custom. And unfortunately, in many countries of the world, it's custom more than the Quran and the Sunnah that prevails. And that's why we have the problems we have. I can argue non-apologetically, really, that it's not Islam that treats women miserably, but the Muslims. And in the name of their own particular and or peculiar cultural milieu. Mm-hmm. My question to Dr. Bakhtiar is, how then do you read the statement in the Prophet's farewell pilgrimage, where he says, I charge you to be good to your wives. You have married them in the through the words of God, and their genitalia were made lawful for you by God's permission. If they, it's not exactly recalcitrant, but if they go out of line, in a way, in the shoes, is that word, then beat them, but not in a way to harm them, غير مبرح, you know, beat them lightly. How do you then fit this into the interpretation of your verse?
Yes, the word nushuz, which is what they claim the wife, the woman is, who is the one who is supposed to be admonished, leave the sleeping place, and then beaten, is translated as disobedient or recalcitrant, I say resistant, and so forth. But the problem is here. In chapter 4, the same exact chapter, verse 148, it says women who fear nishuz, the exact same word of the husband.
Exactly.
And suddenly here we are, we have disobedience with the wives, but when it comes to the husbands, husbands who you fear resistance, husbands who are, I mean, it's a completely different level of interpretation. So I say the Quran is fair and just. The exact same word, exact same diacritical marks, exact same, okay, in both cases. If nishuz for the wife means that, then nishuz for the husband means that. And how many disobedient Muslim husbands have you ever heard of? Or Muslims
husbands? I say if nishuz fits, where? So I know, Professor Ayoub's position on this.
Something
else, all right.
I want to thank you for bringing us together. This has been most stimulating. And our disagreements are
Professor, I have to say that we have 4.5 minutes.
Okay, I'll be quick. We do not actually and should not look at the scriptures directly on their own. One of the problems that we suffer in the Muslim world today is people who read the Quran and do not read it through the tradition and therefore can interpret it sometimes in very violent and very un-Islamic ways. And that happens the same thing with the Armageddon evangelicals who read the Armageddon battle and make it dominate the scene and all the teachings of Christ about loving the enemy and turning the other cheek goes to the birds. The same thing with Judaism. We do not know the Torah from Judaism. We know the Torah through the Mishnah, through the Talmud, through the whole tradition of Judaism. Again, what we need is a way to appreciate and understand who we are and the other, not by trying to include the other in our own personality, if you like. I think that this has been tried many times, the idea of an all-inclusive approach to religion that will take cognizance of all of them. It does not work. What works is for me to read Jewish scriptures as Jews want to read it, to read the Christian scriptures as Christians want to read it, and to read the Quran, not directly, but through the tradition, from the Prophet's time to the present. People have been writing commentaries on the Quran. As we speak here, I'm sure somebody somewhere in the world is writing yet another commentary on the Quran. This has been the problem. What I call Quranic Protestant Muslims who want to base themselves directly and simply on the Quran. And this has been disaster. That's what made the Osama bin Laden's of our time. So again, I think what we are doing is good. This is not to deny that the scriptures are fundamental to our understanding of our lives, of the world, and of our relationship with God. But we have to look at the scriptures as within the tradition of each of the communities. And that would not lend itself to one volume. The Talmud alone is 24 volumes.
It's going to be a thick book if we try to do it that way. Thank you so much, Mr. Ayoub.